So, okay, this is continuation of what Pastor Ron started 2 weeks ago. 2 weeks ago, we started our study on the book of Acts, right? Truth matters. Let me see. Who remembers what we took up? Pastor Ron. It was about, I have to look at my notes. It was about sharing the faith, praying to be a faithful witness, right? Living the truth, sharing the truth. And then last week, of course, we had our musicianary from Japan, Ken Taylor. And what a wonderful message about when troubles come our way, right? Let's go to the source, Jesus Christ. And instead of worrying, let's worship. Instead of panicking, let's be at peace. And instead of fear, let us be faithful. What a wonderful message. So now we're going to continue our study of the book of Acts. Pastor Ron, 2 weeks ago, touched on Acts chapter 1, verses 1 to 14, I believe. We're going to take up a little of that, so there's some overlap. Chapter 1, verses 7 until the end of chapter 1. I think that's verse 26. Okay? So, does truth matter? Does truth matter? Are you a faithful witness? Now I have to get used to this. I hope I'm doing this right. Okay. Are you a faithful witness? The questions to be answered as we go through the book of Acts is Christianity relevant? Is it relevant today? Remember, the book of Acts is when just after Jesus Christ had risen from the dead and go up to heaven, he appeared before his apostles and followers, right? And charged them with the mission of witnessing, testifying. What is the first message of Christianity? And we'll look into that, verse 8, chapter 1. What is the church and what is God's expectation for the church? And we see in the book of Acts, the church as it started right after Jesus Christ ascended into heaven, and really how the church grew, right? And I'll give you a short outline. But we kind of see the authentic version of the church perhaps as God really intended. And the church was meeting from house to house in the homes of the believers under threat of persecution. And we find many parallels today. And in fact, the church spreads like wildfire whenever there is a threat of persecution. Ironically, but we can go into that a little later. So does truth matter? You bet it matters. Think about this. If you lived your life only to find out at the end that you built your life on the wrong foundation, what would you feel like? That you lived a lie, right? That you leaned on the wrong posts. Or worse, what if you never even realized what you're missing? See, the greatest cost of not following Jesus Christ is not knowing what you're missing. What you're missing and what you will miss in eternity. That is the greatest cost of not following Jesus. So sometimes God uses pain to spur us on to seek the truth, because it's only in the truth of God's word that we can find the purpose in our lives. So yes, the truth matters. Now, how many times have you seen this? I saw this 2 days ago in USA Today. And it made my day, it made my month, it made my year. How many times do you see this? Bible classes get a push for public schools. In God we trust. That's USA Today, last Friday. There's a wave of Bible literacy bills in state congresses. If you see here, it's too small, but there are 6 states that are passing Bible bills. Florida, Indiana, Missouri, North Dakota, Virginia, and West Virginia. My question is, where is California? But see, state legislators would allow more students in public schools to study the Old and the New Testament. Proposals from lawmakers in at least 6 states would require or encourage schools to offer elective classes on the Bible's literary and historical perspective. Some of the lawmakers and leaders of Christian groups supporting these bills say they want to restore traditional values in schools and give students a chance to study the religious text deeply. In fact, Republican State Representative Aaron McWilliams, North Dakota, says, "The Bible is an integral part of our society and deserves a place in the classroom." How many times do you hear that said publicly, right? To date, we've heard, you know, the Bible being prayer being banned in schools, in public schools. So this is a breath of fresh air. Now, there are some conservative Christian political groups. One of them is called Wall Builders. By the way, it doesn't have anything to do with the much-debated wall separating the U.S. from Mexico. Nothing to do. The name Wall Builders comes from a biblical reference to grassroots work. Okay? And one of the aims of Wall Builders is to emphasize the moral, religious, and foundational, and constitutional foundation upon which America was built. Can you believe that? That's amen and amen, right? Now, let me give you another example. Truth matters. You cannot hide the truth. In the end, it will always come out. Let me give you one example. Lenny and I just moved to Brentwood 2 weeks ago, as some of you know. And one day, this weekend, we were in Costco. We were in Costco, went to Antioch, which is the neighboring town, right? So we were eating and I struck up a conversation with one of the older women, senior women there. I said, how long, are you from here? Are you from Antioch? And she looked at me like, what is this guy saying? Have you been here in Antioch for long? And then she said, oh, you mean Antioch. Antioch. I said, that's what I said, Antioch, Antioch, Antioch. Antioch. Well, what can I do? My heart tells my mind, tells my mouth to say Antioch because my mouth is a Filipino accent. I cannot hide that. When I first came to the U.S., first thing that my fellow students would say, how you doing? Right? How's it going? Oh, it's going, it's going. Ganon, di ba? That's the way they greet you, right, Sandy? How you doing? Right? But I cannot hide the fact I can change my accent to American if I want to, but that's not me. I cannot hide the truth. I grew up in the Philippines, so my mouth has a Philippine accent. Now, here's another example. Thank you to Brother Ronnie. I don't know if you saw this. I don't know if you saw this. You know, once a sports bum, always a sports bum. How many love sports here? I know, like me, I love sports. I'm fanatic about sports, right? Always a sports bum. Now, what happens next Sunday? Okay, Super Bowl. There was an ad in San Francisco Chronicle posted, again, just this Friday. Thank you, Brother Ronnie, for forwarding this to me. There's an ad, and this man is saying, last year, right after the Super Bowl, last year I bought 2 tickets for the Super Bowl this year, costing $10,000 each. Okay, that's how high prices are. $10,000 each. But I forgot it's my wedding day on Sunday, February 3, the day of the Super Bowl between the Rams and the Patriots, right? So the guy is saying, anyone who wants to take my place, please go to the Millbrae Library, CCF Church, look for Sheila. She's 5'2", 120 pounds, and she will be in the wedding dress. Right? Once a sports bum, always a sports bum. See, whenever I watch the Warriors, right, my wife always wonders, after the game, tapos na yung game, I still stay stuck to CSN Bay Area Sports, whatever telecast. I stay stuck to that for about an hour or two because I like to hear the commentary, kung panalo, if the Warriors win, all right? And then my wife will say, why are you still watching? Tapos na yung game. The game has ended. The Warriors won. Of course, but I want to see, I want to hear all the commentary, all the praises heaped on the Warriors. You know, all these guys, the commentators, I want to hear that. But of course, if the Warriors lose, I turn it off right away. Forget it. All right. So again, the truth will always, always come out. Oops. Okay, truth matters. And Pastor Peter, our senior pastor himself, said, you know, pain is God's way to make us seek the truth. Now, we're continuing our study on the book of Acts. The book of Acts, as Pastor Ron said, is the continuing work of Jesus through the Holy Spirit in the lives of the apostles and his people, right? Now, how do you explain, for example, when the early church was just starting, there were 120, according to the Bible, 120 ordinary men who were able to transform the entire Roman Empire. Very powerful, just after Jesus Christ had ascended. Now, here is our key verse. Let's read it together, please. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses both in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and even to the remotest part of the earth. This is the central verse in our study today, right? Notice the sequence. You have the Holy Spirit within you, you will receive power, and you will witness, or you will testify, right? Question here is, who is your Jerusalem, right? You shall be my witnesses both in Jerusalem. Jerusalem, people close to you, your family, your community, maybe some of the people you work with. That's your circle. Our responsibility is to testify, and the hardest thing to do is to witness before our own family. In all of Judea and Samaria, so you're expanding your borders, and even to the remotest part of the earth. Now, here is an outline of the book of Acts. If you notice, the first stage is the church is born and starts to build up. It's in Jerusalem. It's contained in Acts chapter 1 to chapter 8, chapter 8, verse 4. And the principal character there is Peter, right? Peter, one of the leaders of Jesus Christ's apostles, right? And he was instrumental in starting the church. The second stage, oh, by the way, this took place over a period of 29 years right after Jesus Christ died and rose again. So the year of the Lord 33 until year of the Lord 62. 29 years the church started and grew. Second stage, church bursts, it's expanding. Judea and Samaria, and you can find this in Acts chapter 8 to chapter 12. And the principal character here is Philip, again, one of the apostles. And the third stage is the church goes beyond. It's like CCF beyond, expanding beyond the Philippines, reaching the whole world to the remotest part of the earth, and that's in Acts chapter 13 through the end of Acts chapter 28. And the principal character there is Paul, right? Paul brought God's word to the Gentiles, to the non-Jews. Now, book of Acts, notice, if you go through this, go through chapter 28, verse 31, the book of Acts does not really have an ending. It continues to be written today by you, by us, by the church, by the faithful, by the followers of Christ. Jesus' work continues, the unfolding of what God is going to do through his church. That continues today. So really, the book of Acts has not ended yet. Let's go to the next. So again, the title, Are You a Faithful Witness? Now let me just ask you, and you don't have to respond, from a scale of 1 to 10, 10 being the highest, 1 being the lowest, how would you rate yourself as a witness? Right? Just keep it to yourself. But I would hope that at the end of this session, we can improve that score. What does witness mean? It means to testify as to what you have seen or heard or experienced. That is witness. And the first message of the Christian church is witness to Jesus Christ. The apostles saw him, heard him, lived with him, were in his inner circle. They were charged with witnessing. Right. So here it is, witness. Comes from the Greek word martyros, which means martyr. And as you know, the word martyr or martyrdom is associated with death, right? With death. In the early church, being a faithful witness meant being willing to die for your testimony, for your faith. Right. Tell it as it is. What does witness mean? What is the message, the basic message that God wants us to do, wanted his apostles to do? What is the message? Three things. Jesus died for our sins. Jesus rose from the dead, and Jesus will come again. Now, how many of you here believe that Jesus is not coming again? Is there anyone here who thinks Jesus is not coming again? So we're all in agreement. If you don't, I'll refer you to Pastor Ron. Okay. Now, look at this. Martyrdom is death. Now, what drove these apostles, these brave apostles, to risk their lives in order to witness and to spread the faith? And what will it cost us here today to be an effective witness for Christ? Note how these apostles died, okay? These are examples. By the way, do you know what the difference is between an apostle and a disciple? Anyone? Mm-hmm. So did the disciples during Jesus' time. Apostles means sent out. Sent out. Disciple is a believer. Here's the difference. All the apostles were disciples. They believed, they lived with Christ. They believe in Christ. But not all disciples are apostles. Not all of them were charged or sent out. There were 12 apostles, correct? Right? I'm going to give you more than 12. Why? Because Mark and Luke here, they are gospel writers, that they were not part of the 12 apostles. But look at how these people were martyred. Matthew, he was staked and impaled to the ground by spears and then beheaded in Ethiopia. Mark, dragged through the streets in Alexandria. Luke, he was hanged in Greece. Peter was crucified with his head downward in Rome. Peter said, "I am not worthy to die like my Jesus Christ." Ibitin niyo ako ng patiwarek. What does that mean, Sandy? They hanged him upside down, his head down. And that's how he was crucified. Simon the Zealot was crucified. James, son of Zebedee, to differentiate him from James, the brother of Jesus, beheaded by King Herod near Palestine. John was the only apostle who died a natural death. John. He calls himself the apostle whom Jesus loved. Philip, impaled by iron hooks in his ankles and hung upside down to die. Bartholomew, flayed to death by a whip in Armenia, and his body was torn to shreds. James Alphaeus, James the Less, he was thrown down from the temple by the scribes and the Pharisees. He was stoned and his brains were dashed out with a club. This is rated R stuff, right? These are all martyrs. This is how they died. Andrew, bound to an X-shaped cross in Greece, where he preached to his persecutors until his death. Thomas, the doubting Thomas, he was run through the body by a lance, spear, in the East Indies. Jude, shot to death with arrows. Matthias, who replaced Judas, and we'll go into that later, he was first stoned and then he was beheaded. So let me ask you, what is the cost of being a witness? Well, in Jesus Christ's days and immediately thereafter, it cost them their lives. And not just their lives, they were tortured. They were tortured before they were killed. And what made these people suffer and die for their faith? Well, let me ask you, what will make you suffer for your faith? What will it cost you to be a witness? Now, fortunately, in this day and age, just imagine if we had been born during Jesus Christ's time and we have to go through this. Fortunately for us, we don't have to die these horrible deaths to be a witness. What is the worst thing that can happen if you share your faith? The worst thing that can happen if you share your faith today, you'll be rejected, right? You'll have this reputation, alis na tayo dito, ito na si Rene. He's going to share his faith again. In fact, when I was in college, I went to UP. I and my friends, we used to laugh at the so-called Campus Crusade for Christ. We called them Jesus freaks, right? And there were a lot of them in the University of the Philippines. Every time they came to, ito na, Bible study na, prayer meeting na. Look at these Jesus freaks, little knowing that one day I'd be one of them. Thank God. But that's, you know, what is the greatest cost? How will, you know, what is the worst thing that can happen to you if you share your faith? Ridicule. You'll have a reputation. You know, people will shy away from you like you had body odor, right? Reputation, right? This pales in comparison to what the apostles had to go through. If this is the cost of witnessing, I would gladly be a martyr, right? And as we will see later, the word of Christ, the church, is planted and spread particularly like wildfire in areas where there is the greatest persecution. Even today, places like China, India, right? The Middle East, you know where the greatest growth of CCF is? The CCF satellites? It's in the Middle East. Saudi Arabia, Jeddah, Dubai, United Arab Emirates, you know, where religion is supposedly banned, at least in Saudi Arabia it is. But that, right, Romy, that is where the greatest growth of the Christian church is occurring today. Isn't it ironic? Where there is the threat of suffering, torture, persecution, and death, that is where God's word is flourishing. That's the amazing way that God is working. So, are you a faithful witness? Now, here are the realities. To be a faithful witness, three things must happen. These are the realities. Without these, you cannot be a martyr. Number one, you have a real encounter with Jesus. Number two, you embrace the mission. And number three, you are then empowered by the Holy Spirit. So let's look at this verse again, Acts 1:3. To these, he also presented himself. This is Jesus Christ, alive after his suffering, by many convincing proofs, appearing to them over a period of 40 days and speaking of the things concerning the kingdom of God. Why is, what's the meaning? What is the significance of this? Jesus Christ wanted to offer the whole world infallible proof. Infallible proof. You cannot refute it. He made sure he appeared to his apostles alive, body in the flesh, so there would be no doubt. There would be no uncertainty that he had conquered death. His resurrection, as you know, is foundational. Without Christ's resurrection, there is no salvation. There is no Christianity today. We are living a lie today if Jesus Christ had not resurrected. God wants us to know Jesus is his son and triumphed over death. And Jesus wants us to know he is not just the Messiah, but he is the coming king. So there had to be proof, tangible proof. And that is how he encountered or allowed his apostles to encounter him before they were to go out and witness. Acts 1, chapter verses 6 to 7. So when they had come together, they were asking him, saying, Lord, is it at this time you are restoring the kingdom to Israel? And he said to them, it is not for you to know the times or epochs which the Father has fixed by his own authority. Now, first of all, restoring the kingdom to Israel. The Bible tells us that the headquarters of God's kingdom will be in Israel, will be in Jerusalem. That's one thing. Now, what is Jesus Christ saying here? It is not for you to know. What Jesus Christ is saying, don't waste time speculating, doing all these Bible studies about end times and prophecy and so on. Just do your mission. Witness. Testify. Don't worry about when the end times is coming. There's only one thing sure. Each day that passes brings us closer to Jesus Christ's coming. That's the only thing that is sure. Nobody knows when the end times are coming. Don't worry about it. That's what Jesus Christ is saying. Just do your mission. Witness. Share your faith. Testify to others about me. That is the message of this. So Acts chapter 1, verse 11. They also said, men of Galilee, why? These are the angels, by the way. Men of Galilee, why do you stand? This Jesus who has been taken up from you into heaven will come back in just the same way as you have watched him go into heaven. And that's why we know Jesus Christ is coming again. And the Bible is replete with references to the so-called second coming. So that's number one. You have to have a real encounter with Jesus. Now, at the back of our minds, we're saying, okay, so how are we going to witness? Have you ever had a real encounter with Jesus? Jesus Christ does not appear in body to us today. But he doesn't have to. He doesn't have to. I'm sure each of you has your own God story, right? There are people who witness in public and so on and so forth. I have my God story. I'm sure you, all of you, or most of you at least, have your own God story where you can say, yes, I know Jesus Christ is real because I have seen him work in my life. More accurately, I have seen the Holy Spirit transform my life. And I pray to God that each of you has experienced or will experience that, because that is the start of you being a faithful witness. So number two is embrace the mission. Now here's a study in contrast. To illustrate this point, we are going to use somebody who did not embrace the mission, right? Acts chapter 1, verses 16 to 17. Brethren, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit foretold by the mouth of David concerning Judas. So here is where Judas makes his appearance in the book of Acts. Judas, who became a guide to those who arrested Jesus, for he was counted among us and received his share in the ministry. Judas did not embrace Jesus. He had the privilege, just like the 11 other apostles, right, of having access, personal access to Jesus. He lived with Jesus. He saw Jesus. He heard Jesus. He touched Jesus. He was in the inner circle of Jesus. And yet, he never really surrendered his heart. He never really embraced Jesus, right? Nothing happened. Does this sound familiar? Don't we have stories of maybe siblings, maybe even identical twins? They were raised the same way by their parents, same experiences, same schools even, and yet one turns out to be completely different personality from the other, right? This happens. Judas went through everything that all the apostles went through, but he was kind of turned out different, right? Is there someone like this in your life? We'll go into that a little more. So we begin to see the heart of Judas here. In John 12, verses 4 to 5, but Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, who was intending to betray him, asked, why was this perfume not sold for 300 denarii and the money given to the poor people? So he's starting to reveal his heart now. He was a counterfeit follower of Jesus. He was driven by his own self-interest, his own agenda. Judas was a fake Christian. He faked it, right? So we keep hearing this question even during the retreat, right? Are you really a Christian or are you a fake Christian? What do we call a fake Christian? Christian Christianan. Christian ka ba or are you just a Christian Christianan? And we won't ask Christian there. Christian or Christian Christianan? Is there someone? Let me ask you. It's very easy for us to condemn Judas, right? Right? And very easy for us to condemn someone whom we know has an evil heart, you know, who keeps on sinning. Very easy. But do we look at ourselves? Is there someone of a Judas or something like a Judas inside of us? It doesn't have to be, it doesn't have to be a Jekyll and Hyde personality, like day and night. There is somewhat of a Judas in each of us, right? And let us not be too judgmental and condemning. Remember what Christ said? Before you look at the speck in your brother's eye, you have to note the log in your own eye, right? So lest we be too self-righteous, let's look at ourselves critically and say, yeah, si Judas talagang masama yan. But what about us? Isn't there someone or something like a Judas, some bit of a Judas inside us? Let me give you a really nice story also that one of my friends passed on to me. Three women died by accident, and they went up to the gates of heaven, right? And sure, when they went up to the gates of heaven, in comes, from our old stories, Saint Peter. We call him Saint Peter. It's Peter the Apostle. He's the gatekeeper. He's the gatekeeper to heaven. And he said, come in, women. There's only one rule in heaven. Don't step on the ducks. Don't step on the ducks, whatever you do. So the three women were admitted. On the very first day, the first woman stepped on a duck. The floor of heaven was littered with ducks. It's hard to avoid them. First woman stepped on a duck. Here comes Saint Peter with the ugliest man she had ever seen. Chained this ugly man to her and said, as your penalty, you are going to spend the rest of eternity chained to this ugly man. Second day, the second woman stepped on a duck. Here comes Saint Peter. He doesn't miss a beat. Another, even uglier than the first man, chained to this woman's arm. For your punishment, you will spend the rest of eternity chained to this ugly man. So the third woman, having observed all of these things, was she was extra careful. 1 month passed, 2 months, 6 months, 1 year passed, and she did not step on a duck. On the first day after the first year anniversary, here comes Saint Peter with the most handsome man that she had ever seen. Handsome. Mas pogi lang ng konti kay Brother Romy. The ears were like Brother Romy's ears. The most handsome man. And the third woman said, wow, what did I do to deserve you? And the handsome guy turned to her and said, I don't know about you, but I stepped on a duck. So before you condemn and judge others, right? Look at yourself first. What am I saying here? I mean, we see a lot of Christians, right? They go through the motions, right? They pray, they read the Bible, they attend worship service every Sunday. They will sing praises of worship, exalt team is singing, papikit-pikit sila, taas-taas pa ng kamay. You know, they worship, they volunteer in the ministry, they'll help out, teach Sunday school and all that. And then when they go home, dai, saan yung kape ko? Dai, pakiplansya ng pantalong ko? Dai, chinelas ko? Manila pala yon. That's not how I address my wife, okay? I just say, ma, please make me naman some coffee. Ma, saan yung slippers ko? My point is, there's a bit of a Judas in each of us. Are we real Christians? Have we surrendered ourselves to Christ? Or are we just Christianan? Right? Charles Stanley calls it pretentious religiosity. Pretentious religiosity. It's very easy for us to go through the motions, right, that Christians do. Very easy. But where is our heart? Are we really surrendered? Do we have a relationship with God? Do we want to know more about Jesus Christ? Do we want to follow Jesus Christ's teachings? That is something that only you can say. Do you have the heart for Jesus? John chapter 12, verse 6. Now, he said this not because he was concerned about the poor. We're referring to Judas here. But because he was a thief. So there you go. And as the keeper of the money box, he used to pilfer what was put into it. Judas was a thief. His heart was never right with Jesus. He did not know. He was a treasurer. He did not know the Lord. It's like, you know, the devil knows Jesus. He knows Jesus is God. He's the Son of God. And the devil trembles, right? Jesus was in Judas's head, not in Judas's heart. If the heart is not right, the head will not follow. He wanted to use Jesus for his personal gain. That's why he was asking, why didn't we sell the perfume for 300 denarii? Because then he would have access to all that money. There was no transformation in Judas's heart, right? See, if you allow sin in your life, it will blind you. Now, what was the difference between Judas and Peter? Because both of them fell. Both of them fell. Judas fell, he never repented. Peter fell. Look, in a way, Judas was even better off. In what sense? He did not deny Jesus. In fact, he pointed Jesus out to the Roman captors. But what did Peter do when Jesus was taken? Taken. I don't know this man. Three times. I don't know this man. But what happened after? Peter repented. He was transformed. He had embraced Jesus. That is the difference between Judas. Now, Pastor Peter, our senior pastor, gives us an example. He knows of someone, you know, a pastor who went to the top divinity school here in the U.S. It's the Dallas Theological Seminary. If you go to Dallas Theological Seminary for further studies in divinity, pastoral studies, and so on, that is considered, I think, one of the top schools. That's where your cousin went, Tom. Well, unbeknownst to a lot of people, this guy, having finished, went back home. He had an affair. He was carrying on an extramarital affair. And in fact, he fathered a child out of wedlock. But this is what we mean, you know, by a double standard. There are a lot of Judases in our community. There's even somewhat of a Judas inside each of us. But let's dwell on that topic a little bit more later. John Piper, here it is. If you cannot see the sun, you will be impressed with a street light. If you have never felt thunder and lightning, you will be impressed with fireworks. And if you turn your back on the greatness and majesty of God, you will fall in love with a world of shadows and short-lived pleasures. Again, the greatest cost of not following Jesus is not even knowing what you're missing, right? This was Judas. He never saw beyond the person of Jesus Christ. People who continue to sin and to have immorality in their lives cannot be faithful witnesses. Let's go to Acts chapter 1, the next verses, 18 to 19. Now this man, they're referring to Judas again, acquired a field with the price of his wickedness, and there, falling headlong, he burst open in the middle, and all his guts, intestines, gushed out. And it became known to all who were living in Jerusalem, so that in their own language that field would be called Hakeldama, at his field of blood. Now we are told that Hakeldama actually exists in Jerusalem. Those who have visited Jerusalem, I don't know if you went here. It's now a cemetery. It's an actual place. And this is where Judas, there's no contradiction, by the way, in the book of Matthew and the book of Acts. In the book of Matthew, Judas is said to have hanged himself, right? After hanging himself, apparently he fell and his guts gushed out. So no contradiction there. And he's even in the prophecy in Old Testament, Acts chapter 1, verse 20 says, "For it is written in the book of Psalms, let his homestead be made desolate, and let no one dwell in it." This is from Psalm chapter 69. "And let another man take his office," Psalm chapter 109. So he is in the Old Testament as a prophecy. Now let's go to Acts, next verses, chapter 1, 21 to 22. This is very telling. "Therefore, it is necessary that of the men who have accompanied us all the time, that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us." These are the apostles. "Beginning with the baptism by John until the day that he was taken up from us. One of these must become a witness with us of his resurrection." And again, Judas was part of the 12 who actually lived with Jesus Christ, witnessed Jesus Christ, right? So the requirement or the definition of an apostle is you must be with Jesus from the start of his public ministry when he was baptized by John the Baptist with water to his agony and death until the time that he resurrected from the dead. That is the proof to the apostles that Jesus Christ was real. Is real. But again, Judas gave up this privilege of becoming a follower of Jesus. The point here is life is all about choices. You're free to choose. God gives you your own free will. But you live with the consequences of your choices. Will you align your life's mission with the mission of Jesus Christ? When you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you embrace His mission. When you really encounter Jesus, you will embrace Jesus Christ's mission. Acts, the next verses, chapter 1, verses 23 to 26. So here it is. So they put forward two men, Joseph, also called Barsabbas or Justus, and Matthias. And they prayed. These are the 11 apostles. They prayed and said, "You, Lord, who knows the hearts of all men, show which one of these two." So they were choosing who will replace Judas as the 12th apostle. Joseph or Matthias. "Lord, you know the hearts of these men. Show which one of these two you have chosen to occupy this ministry and this apostleship from which Judas turned aside to go to his own place." And then they drew lots for them, and the lot fell to Matthias, and he was added to the 11 apostles. So complete 12 apostles left. Now, how many of you, I'm sure some of you have experienced this, right? When faced with something where you have to make a decision, or maybe your parents did, you have to choose between two people or two choices, two courses of action, make two decisions. You do it by lots, drawing lots, or more relevant to us, jack and poy, rock, paper, scissors, right? Maybe your mom said, "Oh, sino kayo, who will I give this last piece of bread to?" Right? Is it you or your brother? Jack and poy. It's kind of like drawing lots. In Jesus' time, many things were decided by drawing lots. Now, what's the point here? The apostles, right, pre-selected of all the possible disciples, they narrowed it down. Ito yung short list. Joseph and Matthias. So everything else equal, biblical, everything else equal, they now had to pray and ask the Lord, "Lord, who among those two will you anoint?" Right? It's everything else equal. Again, you're trying to make a decision. It can apply to us. We're trying to say, wait, two job offers. Do I enter and become a banker? Do I become a financial advisor? We face many choices. We pray over them. We say, biblical, you know, I'm not doing anything contrary to the Bible. Everything is equal. Which one do I choose? Right? And you pray to the Lord, "Lord, reveal to me which one is aligned with your will." It's not unusual. Right? So that's what these apostles did. It's a big decision. Who will have the honor of being the 12th apostle? Is it going to be Joseph or is it going to be Matthias? They drew lots and the lot fell to Matthias. And he was the one who was appointed to replace Judas as the 12th apostle. Now, mind you, singles, don't do this when you're trying to choose your life partner. Don't draw lots. No, don't. Talk to Pastor Ron first or talk to some godly counselors. Now, do we do this in the Exalt team? Yes, John, we had to draw lots for John. Where's John? Wala, where's John? He disappeared. I'm just kidding. Exalt team, you don't need to draw lots. Only two things, two requirements. You have to have the heart of worship and you have to have the art of worship. Namely, musical ability. No need to draw lots, right? But again, this was the way that some important decisions were made in Jesus' time. And even today, we always pray. When faced with a problem of choice, assuming everything is aligned with God's teaching, what am I going to choose to do? Who am I going to choose? You pray to the Lord for His will to be done. Next one is Revelation 21, verse 14. "And the wall of the city had 12 foundation stones, and on them were the 12 names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb." What is this saying? This is what the apostles, this is the legacy their reward. They are in the book of Revelations. They are in the kingdom of heaven. The pillars of heaven are each named after the 12 apostles. By contrast, this is what Judas forfeited. This is what he turned his back on. These are amazing privileges that Judas just turned his back on. Beware of sacrificing the eternal for the sake of the temporal. See these faithful witnesses? Their name, they themselves are forever embedded in the kingdom of God in heaven. The cost of disobedience is great. Be a faithful witness. Now, you may not die for your faith. Again, we are fortunate we are living in this day and age. You know the song, the Pambansang Awit? This is the national anthem of the Philippines. What does it end with? Ang mamatay ng dahil sa'yo. To die for you, to die for your country. Right? Is that still relevant today? Let me propose to you, it is harder to live for your country, to live for your faith, than it is to die for your faith. This is what we are called to do, right? We can die for our faith, but it's harder to live out your faith every single day. So one of my friends changed the wording, Pambansang Awit, ang mabuhay ng dahil sa'yo. And this is kind of like what we're saying. Let us live for our faith. We don't need to die for our faith. That's secondary. The more important thing is let us live out our faith. When people look at us, do they see Jesus Christ in us? Do they see the Bible? We are the only Bible that many people will ever see. It's a heavy responsibility. Third, and this is probably the most important thing, empowered by the Holy Spirit. You cannot be a faithful witness without these three realities. You encounter Christ, you embrace the mission. Third is you are empowered by the Holy Spirit. Why is this important? Because the Christian life is not hard. It is impossible. But with God, everything is possible. The Christian life is not difficult. It is supernatural. Without the Holy Spirit, we cannot live the Christian life. By ourselves, we cannot live the Christian life. That is why we need the Holy Spirit. Now, here's an excellent opportunity to know more about the Holy Spirit. It says, again, our key verse, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses, both in Jerusalem, Judea and Samaria, and the remotest part of the earth. Let's go into the deity and personhood, the person of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the most misunderstood member of the Trinity. Now, this is heavy stuff. One of the foundational doctrines or articles of our faith is the Trinity. And I'm sure you're all familiar with this. Growing up, you know, in a religious school, the Trinity, the concept of the God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. But there continues to be a lot of misconception. We believe the Holy Spirit is God and possesses all the divine attributes. He indwells all believers and baptizes them into the body of Christ. At the moment that you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you are saved, and the Holy Spirit then indwells you and sanctifies you. What does that mean? He makes you more and more Christ-like. If you have truly accepted Jesus Christ in your heart, and only you can say, only it's between you and God. So the Holy Spirit indwells all believers at the moment that they trust in Jesus Christ to be their Savior and Lord. He controls all true believers and empowers us to live the Christian life. In response to our obedience, confession of sins, and submission to Him. Right? So Acts 1, 4-5, gathering them together, He commanded them to not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait for what the Father had promised, the Holy Spirit. You will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. I think Jeremy will take this up maybe next Sunday. Simply put, the Holy Spirit is God. He is a divine person with a mind, with emotions, with a will. Just like God the Father, just like God the Son. Easily the most misunderstood member of the Trinity, as I said. The ministry of the Holy Spirit is very intimate. It's very personal. He pours out God's love in our hearts. He is our comforter and our helper. The promise of the indwelling Holy Spirit is an essential part of the new covenant. Right? We see Him in the Old Testament, but we see Him even more clearly in the New Testament because it was Jesus Christ's command. Wait until my Father sends you the Holy Spirit. Ezekiel, here's an example of the Old Testament reference. Ezekiel chapter 36, verse 27. I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you will be careful to observe my ordinances. Right. So here's a quote from the preacher Charles Sturgeon, 19th century preacher. Without the Spirit of God, we can do nothing. We are like ships without wind, or chariots without steeds. Like branches without sap, we are withered. Like coals without fire, we are useless. As an offering without the sacrificial flame, we are unaccepted. It's like saying you are a body or you are flesh without blood. Now let's look further. John 16, 7 to 8, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. Jesus Christ is speaking. Because if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I go, I will send Him to you. And when He comes, He will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment. So it's also important. Okay, we know who the Holy Spirit is. He is a person. He is God. Let's also know who He is not. And this is where the misconceptions come from. There are a lot of false teachings about the Holy Spirit. For example, the New Age movement, the occult sciences, even Star Wars is saying He is like a mystical force. May the force be with you. Right? The Holy Spirit is not a mystical force. He is not an impersonal power. You know, this belief of animism refers to the Holy Spirit as if He were some impersonal power. The Holy Spirit is a person to be worshipped, not a power to be abused. He is not a creation of God. He does not flow out of God. He is not inferior to God. He is not subordinate to God. Why? He is God. The Holy Spirit is God. That's the only thing you have to remember about the Holy Spirit. He is God. He possesses all the divine attributes. He is co-equal with the Father and the Son. The doctrine of the Trinity, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, they are all co-equally God and together form the eternal God. He is all-knowing, omniscient. He is present everywhere, omnipresent. He is all-powerful, omnipotent. The Word of God was authored by the Holy Spirit. Look at this quote from John chapter 16, verse 13. When He, the Spirit of truth, comes, He will guide you into all truth. For He will not speak on His own initiative, but whatever He hears, He will speak and He will disclose to you what is to come. It's like, as Pastor Peter said, when He evangelizes and shares the faith, it is not Him who changes the heart. It is the Holy Spirit who convicts. Let's look at this passage. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. By the way, the Corinthians were one of the most immoral communities in the time of the apostles when they were starting the church. Very problematic. Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor homosexuals, nor thieves, nor the covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor slanderers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. Don't deceive yourselves. But here is something, the next verse says, such were some of you, but you were washed and you were sanctified, but you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and in the Spirit of God. Only the Holy Spirit can sanctify us, can sanctify you. He can do something dramatic to change you. So what are the works of the Holy Spirit? The world was created by Him. He is God. The Word was authored by Him. The Bible, Scripture, was authored by the Holy Spirit. God breathed. Jesus was conceived by Him. Luke chapter 1, verse 35. The angel answered and said to her, Mary, mother of Jesus, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. And for that reason, the Holy Child shall be called the Son of God. It is the Holy Spirit who conceived Jesus Christ. So again, the Holy Spirit is a person with intellect, with emotions, with a will. He loves us. He convicts us of sin. He can be offended. He can be grieved by sin. He directs the activities of our lives. He makes decisions. He guides us into truth by giving us understanding of His Word. How many of you have experienced, when you read the Bible, when you read Scripture, first time you read the passage, you don't understand what it's saying. And then sometimes you go back to it a second time, maybe a third time, and then there's some illumination. The Holy Spirit gives you some insight. Ah, now I know what this passage is saying. I'll be honest, I read the Bible from cover to cover for the first time this year. I wanted to say, I read the Bible, because Bible is God's Word. It is there for you. It is free. It's a free app. You can easily get the Bible, a copy of the hardbound copy of the Bible. So I read the Bible from cover to cover. There are instances, passages where, honestly, I fall asleep. So what am I doing? I'm going back. I miss this. And upon second reading or repetition, I get some insight. You have to read the Bible reflectively. You don't rush into it. I have to confess, there were times when, because I wanted to finish the Bible within 1 year, right? They keep saying, Bible in 1 year. Actually, I said, I'm going to finish this in 10 months. But in my desire to finish the Bible, I was losing sight of the purpose. What is the purpose of reading the Bible? You want to know God's Word. I just wanted to finish chapter, this next chapter, Old Testament book. I want to go into the next book and then on into the New Testament. So I lost sight. Now I'm going back. Oh, this is what I missed. The Holy Spirit illuminates you. There's nothing secret. There are a lot of mysteries in the Bible, but if you seek in earnest, you will find, and it's the Holy Spirit's work, right? He prays for us. Remember Romans 8:26, He intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. He equips and He empowers us for service. The Holy Spirit, He can be disobeyed. He can be lied to. He can be, I can't read my own writing. He can be resisted. He can be offended. He can be grieved. He can be insulted, just like Jesus Christ. He is a person. He is not some mystical force or power. Here's another saying. Success in witnessing is sharing the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ in the power of the Holy Spirit and leaving the results to God. All right. When we were going through evangelism training, when was this? 8 years ago, maybe? Pastor Rene Achenza came here. That's his specialty. He broke us into groups. And as practical experience, okay, you know what you want to say, the articles of faith and all that, right? EV2, we call it, everyday evangelism. And On the job training, we would select a target, not a target, but a candidate for sharing. And we would go out in twos, threes, fours, right? And we would share the gospel. And we would continue doing it. After that, you know, there's my neighbor in San Mateo when we used to live there, you know, I would walk my dog and I'd see this old man just walking around. One time I saw him in McDonald's near our place and I said, hey, can I share something with you? So I shared the gospel. Another time I saw a realtor friend of ours, you know, he's a very nice guy, and I saw him in the grocery. I sat him down, hey, can I share with you something about a very priceless piece of real estate that you will might live in into eternity? You know, and honestly, I never saw those guys again. And every time we went out and shared the gospel, we would do a checklist. Okay, prayed to receive Jesus Christ. You know, it was all statistical and all that. But how are we to know that what we share is impacting the hearts of these people that we are sharing with? You never really know. And sometimes, you know, you will lose contact, you won't see them again. And sometimes you will just hear, wow, this person has accepted Christ and he has changed his life around. What is my point? Your job is to share the gospel, testify, witness, and then leave everything to God. Leave everything to the Holy Spirit. Right? That is your job. It's not you who transforms. It's not you who changes hearts. It is not you who convicts. It's the Holy Spirit. Just share the word. Boom. That is your responsibility. Let God do the rest. Like someone said,